Laudator Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ, and welcome to the liturgy presided over by Pope Francis on the occasion of the World Day of the Poor, celebrated on this, the 33rd Sunday in Ordinary Time. On behalf of Vatican Media, I would like to welcome you very much to this broadcast. My name is Father Jan, and it will be my pleasure to provide the English language commentary for this liturgy. On behalf of Vatican News, I'd like to welcome all of you who are joining us for this liturgy from around the world. Welcome to those of you joining us through various Vatican media channels, through the Vatican News web portal or app, or the YouTube channel. Welcome to those of you joining us through EWTN, Catholic TV, Shalom World TV, Salt and Light TV, and the Catholic Faith Network. You're all very welcome, along with those joining through other radio stations or internet sources throughout the world. The World Day of the Poor is a Roman Catholic observance celebrated on this, the 33rd Sunday of Ordinary Time, since 2017. It was established by Pope Francis in his apostolic letter, Misericordia et Misera, issued on the 20th of November 2016, which celebrated the end of the extraordinary Jubilee Year of Mercy. You join us as the Holy Father is processing with the concelebrants to the altar. We see the Holy Father bowing now as he, with those whom he concelebrates this Mass, come to the altar to begin this liturgy of the Eucharist, when we are nourished by the Lord in word and in sacrament. As we watch the Holy Father progress to the altar and venerate and ultimately incense the altar at the beginning of this liturgy, let's just think for a moment about this World Day of the Poor, which in his letter, that apostolic letter that I've just spoken about, Pope Francis expresses his wishes for this day. During the Jubilee for socially excluded people, as the holy doors of mercy were being closed in all the cathedrals and shrines of the world, I had the idea that as yet, another tangible sign of this extraordinary holy year, the entire Church might celebrate on the 33rd Sunday of Ordinary Time, the World Day of the Poor. This, Pope Francis said, would be the worthiest way to prepare for the celebration of the solemnity of our Lord Jesus Christ, King of the universe, who identified with the little ones and the poor, and who will judge us on our works of mercy. It would be a day to help communities and each of the baptized to reflect on how poverty is at the very heart of the gospel, and that as long as Lazarus lies at the door of our homes, there can be no justice or social peace. This day will also represent a genuine form of new evangelization, which can renew the face of the Church as she perseveres in her perennial activity of pastoral conversion and witness to mercy. Those words of Pope Francis are good to reflect on as we begin this Mass. We see Pope Francis incensing the altar and preparing himself now to lead this congregation in St. Peter's Basilica in the celebration of Mass on this, the 33rd Sunday of Ordinary Time and the World Day of Prayer for the Poor. And so the Holy Father at the chair begins this Mass.
In nome del Padre, del Figlio e dello Spirito Santo.
Amen.
La pace sia con voi.
E con il tuo spirito.
Fratelli, per celebrare degnamente i santi misteri, riconosciamo i nostri peccati.
We join with those now in the Basilica who pause in silence to recollect their sins and ask the Lord for his mercy and for his forgiveness.
Confesso a Dio
onnipotente e a voi fratelli che ho molto peccato in pensieri, parole, opere e omissioni, per mia colpa, mia grandissima colpa, e supplico la beata sempre Vergine Maria, gli angeli, i santi e voi fratelli di pregare per me il Signore Dio nostro.
Dio onnipotente, abbia misericordia di noi, perdoni i nostri peccati e ci conduca alla vita eterna.
The choir now sings in Italian the Lord have mercy. And as each Sunday, the choir now leads us in the singing of the Glory to God in the Highest, uniting the whole Church to the glory and the praise of God.
Preghiamo. Il tuo aiuto, Signore, ci renda sempre lieti nel tuo servizio.
Grant us, we pray, O Lord our God, the constant gladness of being devoted to you, for it is full and lasting happiness to serve with constancy the author of all that is good.
Nell'unità dello Spirito Santo per tutti I secoli dei secoli.
The Holy Father and the congregation are seated now as we begin the liturgy of the Word. Our first reading today at Mass from the prophet Malachi will be read in English.
A reading from the prophet Malachi. The day is coming now, burning like a furnace, and all the arrogant and evildoers will be like stubble. The day that is coming is going to burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, leaving them neither root nor stalk. But for you who fear my name, the Sun of Righteousness will shine out with healing in its rays.
Verbum Domini.
Deo gratia.
We make our response to the reading in the responsorial psalm today, which is Psalm 97. The Lord comes to rule the peoples with fairness.
Il Signore giudicherà il mondo con giustizia.
Il Signore giudicherà il mondo con giustizia.
Cantate inni al Signore con la cetra e al suono di strumenti a corde. Con la tromba.
Sing psalms to the Lord with the harp, with the sound of music, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Acclaim the King, the Lord. Let the sea and all within it thunder, the world and all its peoples. Let the rivers clap their hands, and the hills ring out their joy at the presence of the Lord.
Davanti al Signore che viene, a giudicare la terra.
For the Lord comes, he comes to rule the earth. He will rule the world with justice and the peoples with fairness.
E I popoli con rettitudine.
Il Signore giudicherà il mondo con giustizia.
We now listen to our second reading, which comes from the second letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians, and will be read in Spanish.
Lectura de la segunda carta del apóstol San Pablo a los tesalonicenses. Hermanos, ya sabéis vosotros cómo tenéis que imitar nuestro ejemplo. No vivimos entre nosotros sin trabajar.
You know how you are supposed to imitate us. Now, we were not idle when we were with you, nor did we ever have our meals at anyone's table without paying for them. No, we worked night and day, slaving and straining, so as not to be a burden on any of you. This was not because we had no right to be, but in order to make ourselves an example for you to follow. We gave you a rule when we were with you, not to let anyone have any food if he refused to do any work. Now we hear that there are some of you who are living in idleness, doing no work themselves, but interfering with everyone else's. In the Lord Jesus Christ, we order and call on people of this kind to go on quietly working and earning the food that they eat.
Extornamos por el Señor Jesucristo que trabajen con sosiego para comer su propio pan.
Verbum Domini.
The choir now lead the congregation in the singing of the Alleluia, which prepares us for the Gospel. Stand erect, hold your heads high, because your liberation is near at hand. The deacon, having received the blessing from Pope Francis, walks in procession accompanied by the incense and candles to the lectern, which is placed in the front of the altar in the Basilica here at St. Peter's. And together now we prepare ourselves to listen to the words of Jesus, who speaks to us in the Gospel that is proclaimed.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Lucam.
Gloria tibi Domine.
Today's Gospel is from St. Luke. The deacon now incenses the Gospel to show honour to the Book of Gospels, from which the words of Jesus will now be proclaimed.
In quel tempo, mentre alcuni parlavano del Tempio, che era ornato di belle pietre e di doni votivi,
when some were talking about the temple, remarking how it was adorned with fine stonework and votive offerings, Jesus said, "All these things you are staring at now, the time will come when not a single stone will be left on another. Everything will be destroyed." And they put to him this question, "Master," they said, "when will this happen then? And what sign will there be that this is about to take place?" "Take care not to be deceived," he said, "because many will come using my name and saying, 'I am he,' and the time is near at hand. Refuse to join them. And when you hear of wars and revolutions, do not be frightened, for this is something that must happen, but the end is not so soon." Then he said to them, "Nation will fight against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and plagues and famines here and there. There will be fearful sights and great signs from heaven. But before all this happens, men will seize you and persecute you. They will hand you over to the synagogues and to imprisonment, and bring you before kings and governors because of my name. And that will be your opportunity to bear witness. Keep this carefully in mind. You are not to prepare your defense, because I myself shall give you an eloquence and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, relations and friends, and some of you will be put to death. You will be hated by all men on account of my name, but not a hair of your head will be lost. Your endurance will win you your lives."
Con la vostra perseveranza salverete la vostra vita.
Verbum Domini.
Lausti di Christe.
The deacon takes the book of the Gospels in procession, and the Holy Father now prepares to preach his homily. The congregation will listen, as we do, to the words of Pope Francis on this World Day of the Poor, this 33rd Sunday of Ordinary Time.
Oggi nel Vangelo Gesù sorprende i suoi contemporanei e anche noi. Infatti, proprio mentre si lodava il magnifico tempio di Gerusalemme.
In today's Gospel, Jesus astounds both his contemporaries and us. While everyone else was praising the magnificent temple in Jerusalem, Jesus tells them that one stone will not be left upon another. Why does he speak these words about so sacred an institution, which was not merely a building, but a unique religious symbol, a house for God and for the believing people? Why does he prophesy that the firm certitude of the people of God would collapse? Why ultimately does the Lord let our certitudes collapse, when our world has fewer and fewer of them?
Egli oggi ci dice che quasi
Let us look for answers in the words of Jesus. He tells us that almost everything will pass away. Almost everything, but not everything. On this next to the last Sunday in ordinary time, he explains that what will collapse and pass away are the penultimate things, not the ultimate ones. The temple, not God. Kingdoms and human events, not humanity itself. The penultimate things, which often appear definitive, but they are not, pass away. They are majestic realities like our temples, and terrifying ones like earthquakes. They are signs in heaven and wars on the earth. To us, these are front-page news. But the Lord puts them on the second page. That which will never pass away remains on the front page. The living God, infinitely greater than any temple we build for him, and the human person, our neighbor, who is worth more than all the news reports of the world. So help us to realize what really counts in life. Jesus warns us about two temptations. The first is the temptation of haste, of the right now. For Jesus, we must not follow those who tell us that the end is coming immediately, that the time is at hand. That is, we must not follow the alarmists who fuel fear of others and of the future, for fear paralyzes the heart and mind. Yet how often do we let ourselves be seduced by a frantic desire to know everything right now, by the itch of curiosity, by the latest sensational or scandalous news, by lurid stories, by screaming those who shout loudest and angriest, by those who tell us it is now or never? This haste, this everything right now, does not come from God. If we get worked up about the right now, we forget what remains forever. We follow the passing clouds and lose sight of the sky. Drawn by the latest outcry, we no longer find time for God or for our brother and sister living next door. How true this is today. In the frenzy of running, of achieving everything right now, anyone left behind is viewed as a nuisance and considered disposable. How many elderly, unborn, disabled, and poor persons are considered useless? We go our way in haste, without worrying that gaps are increasing, that the greed of a few is adding to the poverty of many others. As an antidote to haste, Jesus proposes to each of us perseverance. By your endurance, you will gain your lives. Perseverance entails moving forward each day with our eyes fixed on what does not pass away, the Lord and our neighbor. This is why perseverance is the gift of God that preserves all his other gifts. Let us ask that each of us, and all of us as the Church, may persevere in the good and not lose sight of what really counts. There is a second illusion that Jesus wants to spare us. He says, "Many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he.' Do not go after them." It is the temptation of self-centeredness. Christians, since we do not seek the right now, but the forever, are not concerned with the me, but with the you. Christians, that is, do not follow the siren song of their whims, but rather the call of love, the voice of Jesus. How is Jesus' voice discerned? Many will come in my name, the Lord says, but they are not to be followed. Wearing the label Christian or Catholic is not enough to belong to Jesus. We need to speak the same language as Jesus, that of love, the language of the you. Those who speak the language of Jesus are not the ones who say I, but rather the ones who step out of themselves. And yet how often, even when we do good, does the hypocrisy of self take over? I do good so that I can be considered good. I give in order to receive in turn. I offer help so that I can win the friendship of some important person. That is how the language of self speaks. The Word of God, however, spurs us to a genuine love, to give to those who cannot repay us, to serve others without seeking anything in return. So let us ask ourselves, do I help someone who has nothing to give me in return? Do I, as a Christian, have at least one poor person as a friend?
Perché non parlano la lingua di Dio. Non si sostengono da soli, con le proprie forze.
The poor are valuable in the eyes of God because they do not speak the language of self. They do not support themselves on their own, by their own strength. They need someone to take them by the hand. The poor remind us how we should live the gospel, like beggars reaching out to God. The presence of the poor makes us breathe the fresh air of the gospel, where the poor in spirit are blessed. Instead of feeling annoyed when they knock on our doors, let us welcome their cry for help as a summons to go out of ourselves, to welcome them with God's own loving gaze.
Che bello se I poveri occupassero nel nostro cuore il posto che hanno nel cuore di Dio.
How beautiful it would be if the poor could occupy in our hearts the place they have in the heart of God, standing with the poor, serving the poor. We see things as Jesus does. We see what remains and what passes away. Let us return to our initial questions. Amid so many penultimate and passing realities, the Lord wants to remind us today of what is ultimate, what will remain forever. It is love. Love for God is love. The poor person who begs for my love leads me straight to God. The poor facilitate our access to heaven. This is why the sense of the faith of God's people has viewed them as the gatekeepers of heaven. Even now, they are our treasure, the treasure of the Church. For the poor reveal to us the riches that never grow old, that unite heaven and earth, the riches for which life is truly worth living, the riches of love. The congregation sit in silence for a few moments to reflect on the words of Pope Francis in his homily. We too can reflect on those words. Pope Francis said, "How many elderly, unborn, disabled, and poor persons are considered useless? We go our way in haste without worrying that gaps are increasing, that the greed of a few is adding to the poverty of many others. And Pope Francis reminds us that the poor are valuable in the eyes of God, because they do not speak the language of self. They do not support themselves on their own, by their own strength, but need someone to take them by the hand. Pope Francis asks us, if we are going to be the type of Christian that takes the poor by the hand, that helps our brothers and sisters, not seeing them as a burden, but serving them in joy. Listen again to Pope Francis say, how beautiful it would be if the poor could occupy in our hearts the place they have in the heart of God. Standing with the poor, we see things as Jesus does. We see what remains and what passes away. The congregation now stand with Pope Francis to recite the Creed in Italian, and we too make our profession of faith on this Sunday, the Lord's Day.
Per mezzo di Lui tutte le cose sono state create, per noi uomini e per la nostra salvezza discese dal cielo, e per opera dello Spirito Santo si è incarnato nel seno della Vergine Maria e si è fatto uomo. Fu crocifisso per noi sotto Ponzio Pilato, morì e fu sepolto, il terzo giorno è risuscitato secondo le Scritture, è salito al cielo, siede alla destra del Padre e di nuovo verrà nella gloria per giudicare i vivi e i morti e il suo regno non avrà fine. Credo nello Spirito Santo che è Signore e dà la vita e procede dal Padre e dal Figlio e con il Padre il Figlio è adorato, glorificato e ha parlato per mezzo dei profeti. Credo la Chiesa, una, santa, cattolica, apostolica. Professo un solo battesimo per il perdono dei peccati. Aspetto la risurrezione dei morti e la vita del mondo che verrà. Amen.
Fratelli carissimi, innalziamo la nostra preghiera al Signore Gesù, nostro unico bene.
Dear brothers and sisters, let us begin our prayer to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our only good, and from him receive our help and salvation.
Metti sulle labbra della Chiesa una parola vera.
Place on the lips of the Church a true word. Help governments to work for the good.
Dona perseveranza ai cristiani perseguitati.
Give perseverance to persecuted Christians.
Concedi pace e tranquillità a tutti i popoli.
Give peace and tranquility to all people.
Ravviva nei tuoi discepoli la vigilanza.
Revive in your disciples the gift of vigilance.
Raggiungi con i tuoi raggi benefici quanti temono il tuo nome.
Give your blessings to those who fear your name.
Colma di ogni vero bene tutti i poveri della terra.
Give true good and benefits to all the poor of the earth.
Suscita numerosi operai del Vangelo e della grazia.
Bring alive many workers for your gospel.
Ridesta nei battezzati il desiderio della santità.
Give to all the baptized a desire for holiness.
Signore Gesù, che sempre ti chini sull'umanità sofferente e peccatrice. Guarda la
Lord Jesus, you always bend down to the suffering and sinful humanity. Guard our poverty and be our help, you who live and reign for ever and ever. Amen. With the universal prayer that we have just prayed, the Liturgy of the Word is complete, and we move now into the Liturgy of the Eucharist. The altar is being prepared by the deacons and the ministers, and the gifts of bread and wine, which will be used in this Mass, are brought to the Holy Father by representatives of the congregation, including those of our poor brothers and sisters who are in the Basilica celebrating this Mass. As those members of the congregation bring forward gifts of bread and wine to celebrate the Eucharist, which, as we know from the Acts of the Apostles, the disciples and the first Christian communities, as they celebrated the Eucharist, what they celebrated took shape in their lives, particularly in their concern for the weak and the vulnerable, for the poor and for the needy. And it's that same sense that guides the Church today. The World Day of Poor was first observed on the 19th of November 2017 with the theme, Let us love not with words but with deeds. In his message for the first World Day of the Poor, Pope Francis said that the Our Father is the prayer of the poor. He held a special Mass in St. Peter's Basilica, followed by a free lunch in the adjacent Paul VI Hall, in several Catholic colleges, and in other Vatican venues. During the week preceding the World Day of the Poor, free specialized medical services were offered at a mobile clinic. In this way, the fruits that flow from the Eucharist, from the Eucharistic Lord and his presence, become real in the life of the Church. We see the Holy Father now offer the gifts of bread and wine, which will be consecrated at this Mass, that will become the body and blood of Jesus Christ, that we will receive in Holy Communion at Mass. It calls us to look for the needs of the poor. Last year, on the World Day of Prayer for the Poor and its lead up to it, over 3,500 people were tended to by doctors and nurses. This year, the clinic opened last Sunday and will remain open till this afternoon. This clinic, which is set up in the piazza, in the square outside St. Peter's. Very, very visible, and inviting the many poor and the vulnerable, which those of us who live in Rome see and witness on our streets each day, enabling them to come and receive treatment, to be cared for. After today's Mass, Pope Francis will have lunch once again in the Paul VI Hall with over 1,500 poor people from Rome and throughout the Lazio region. In these ways, Pope Francis is encouraging us through the Eucharist that we celebrate. As we receive Jesus in the Eucharist, to offer the gift that we have received to others, to live the life that Jesus offers to us. And so as the Holy Father has incensed the altar, and now as he, as the celebrant of the Mass, and the concelebrants and all the lay faithful are incensed, perhaps that can be our prayer as we pray this Mass today, that we too will have the courage to listen to the voice of the Lord who speaks through the most poor, through the weak and the vulnerable. And as Pope Francis encouraged us in his homily, create the opportunity to truly befriend and serve those who are poor.
Pregate fratelli perché mio vostro sacrificio sia gradito a Dio Padre onnipotente.
Il Signore riceva dalle tue mani questo sacrificio, all'ode e gloria del suo nome, per il bene nostro e di tutta la sua santa Chiesa.
Questa offerta che ti presentiamo a Dio onnipotente.
Grant, O Lord, we pray, that what we offer in the sight of your Majesty may obtain for us the grace of being devoted to you and gain us the prize of everlasting happiness.
In alto i nostri cuori. Rendiamo grazie al Signore nostro Dio.
E cosa buona e giusta.
E veramente cosa buona e giusta renderti grazie e alzare a te l'inno di benedizione e di lode, Dio onnipotente ed eterno. Tu hai creato il mondo nella varietà dei suoi elementi.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man and woman in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels we praise you, and in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Padre veramente santo, a te la lode da ogni creatura. Per mezzo di Gesù Cristo, tuo figlio, nostro Signore, nella potenza.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you.
Dopo la cena, allo stesso modo prese il calice.
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
Mistero della fede.
Annunciamo la tua morte, Signore. Proclamiamo la tua risurrezione nell'attesa della tua venuta.
Celebrando il memoriale del tuo figlio morto per la nostra salvezza.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your Church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
Faccia di noi un sacrificio perenne a te gradito, perché possiamo ottenere il regno promesso in.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Per Cristo, con Cristo e in Cristo. A te, Dio Padre Onnipotente, nell'unità dello Spirito Santo,
ogni onore e gloria per tutti i secoli dei secoli.
Amen.
Signore ci ha donato il suo spirito. Con la fiducia e la libertà dei figli diciamo insieme.
Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentation, libera la nostra mano.
Liberaci, oh Signore, da tutti i mali. Concedi la pace ai nostri giorni. Con l'aiuto della tua misericordia vivremo sempre liberi dal peccato, sicuri da ogni turbamento, nell'attesa che si compia la beata speranza e venga il nostro Salvatore Gesù Cristo. Signore Gesù Cristo, che hai detto ai tuoi apostoli, vi lascio la pace, vi do la mia pace. Non guardare ai nostri peccati, ma alla fede della tua Chiesa, e donale unità e pace secondo la tua volontà. Tu che vivrai nei secoli dei secoli.
Amen.
Pace del Signore sia sempre con voi.
E con il tuo spirito.
Scambiatevi un segno di pace.
The deacon invites all those present in the basilica to offer to each other a sign of peace, which the Holy Father now does to those nearest to him at the altar, the bishops who are concelebrating, and those ministers who are serving at the altar, and the congregation turn to each other and offer each other a sign of peace, a sign surely of our unity in faith before we receive the Lord, but today also a sign of turning our hand to our brother and sister and greeting them, giving to them the Lord's love. The congregation now joins to sing the Lamb of God with the choir.
Thank you.
Beati invitati alla cena del Signore. Ecco l'agnello di Dio che toglie i peccati del mondo.
Oh Signore, non sono degno di partecipare alla tua messa, ma di soltanto una parola e io sarò salvato.
We join with those in the Basilica to say, Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The Holy Father receives Holy Communion at this Mass, and in a few moments Communion will be distributed among all those present, the faithful in the Basilica. For those of us watching this Mass or listening to it, and who can't participate in Holy Communion, can pray in our hearts and minds that we will always be ready to receive the Lord who comes to us in the Eucharist and desire him, even though at this moment we are unable to receive him. Lord Jesus, open my heart, open my mind to your love. May you be adored in the most blessed sacrament of the altar. The choir have just sung the antiphon, Amen, I say to you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you will receive, and it shall be given to you, says the Lord. As the choir sing the anthem, where there is love and charity, there is God, we can just reflect for a few moments about the practical nature of this World Day of Prayer for the Poor and this Mass that we're celebrating. On Friday, Pope Francis inaugurated the new night and daycare centre for the homeless people near St. Peter's Square as part of what has become his initiative of Fridays of Mercy. A palace for the poor is just what Pope Francis blessed on Friday afternoon, just ahead of this World Day of the Poor. The four-story Vatican property sits in a prestigious location, just right off the colonnade of St. Peter's Square. It still carries the name of the Roman family that built it in the 1800s. The Palazzo Migliori, or the Palace of the Best. Acquired by the Vatican in the 1930s, the building was recently vacated by a congregation of religious sisters. Pope Francis personally directed his almoner, Cardinal Konrad Krajewski, to turn it into a place where the homeless and the poor of Rome can sleep, eat, and learn. This charitable operation is staffed and run by the Sant'Egidio community. In a communique, Cardinal Krajewski described how the palace is to be used. The upper two floors are dormitories, where about 50 men and women can sleep, though it is able to host more when the Roman temperatures plummet and the need is greater. Those guests are offered breakfast and supper in the refectory on the second floor. Volunteers, he said, will also be able to use the kitchen to prepare hot meals to be distributed in the evenings to the homeless who find shelter at one of Rome's train stations. During the day, the bottom two floors provide space for volunteers to teach those who are in need, teaching them to use a computer, perhaps. There's also space for reading, recreation, and psychological counselling. The construction company that renovated this Palazzo Migliore, the Palace of the Best, employed a group of homeless people at the Vatican's urging. The company was so impressed by their work ethic that it hired them. These are the very practical initiatives that Pope Francis is witnessing to the whole church. And our hope on this day is that the Palazzo will be used by many of those people in Rome who need to use it for sustenance, for sleep, to learn, to be looked after. This is the very practical way in which the celebration of the Eucharist flows into our daily lives. The Eucharist that is being celebrated here today in St. Peter's Basilica. As we listen to the choir sing the psalm, "The Lord's My Shepherd," and as those in the Basilica pray after receiving Holy Communion, once again we can hear the words of Pope Francis in that beautiful homily of this Mass. The poor, he said, facilitate our access to heaven. This is why the sense of the faith of God's people has viewed them as the gatekeepers of heaven. Even now, they are our treasure, the treasure of the Church. For the poor reveal to us the riches that never grow old, that unite heaven and earth, the riches for which life is truly worth living, the riches of love. There is a moment of silence now before the Holy Father leads us in the final prayer of this Mass. And as we look around the Basilica, we see the many faces of an international city here in Rome, the community of the Church, gathered to celebrate the Eucharist on this, the Lord's Day. This Eucharist which compels us to not turn into and look only at ourselves, not to look at the eye, as Pope Francis said, but to turn to the needs of the poor. Our celebration of Holy Mass always takes us out of ourselves and leads us to the place where the Lord wants us to be, if only we are open to him in prayer and trust in his goodness. So the Holy Father stands now to lead us in the final prayers of the Mass.
Preghiamo. O Padre, che ci hai nutriti con questo sacramento, ascolta.
We have partaken of the gifts of this sacred mystery, humbly imploring, O Lord, that what your Son commanded us to do in memory of him may bring us growth in charity through Christ our Lord.
Signore sia con voi.
E con il tuo spirito.
Inchinatevi per la benedizione.
Assisti il tuo popolo, Signore.
Assist your people, Lord, and do not deprive your blessing upon the earth, especially to those called to an eternal hope.
E la benedizione di Dio onnipotente, Padre, Figlio e Spirito Santo, discenda su di voi e con voi rimanga sempre.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.
The Holy Father approaches the statue of Our Lady, the image of Our Lady in the Basilica, while the choir and the congregation sing a hymn in honor of Our Lady. O Holy Virgin, pray for me. O Holy Virgin, pray for me. The prayer of all of those in the Basilica as this Mass is drawing to a close. So the Holy Father, having venerated the altar, joins the concelebrants to process out of the Basilica, and so concludes this Mass for the 33rd Sunday in Ordinary Time, and the Mass for the World Day of the Poor. Just to let you know that full coverage of today's liturgy and other Vatican and world news can be found on the Vatican News web portal, on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and the Twitter accounts. We will be back shortly, at noontime in Rome, for the weekly broadcast of the Pope's Sunday recitation of the Angelus with the faithful gathered in St. Peter's Square. On behalf of Vatican Media, we would like to thank you for joining us. We'd like to thank the production staff here in the studio and all those who've helped in this broadcast today. Have a very blessed Sunday. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ.